with Esoteric Freemasonry Unveiled. My name is Jeremiah Waterchild, and I am a Freemason. I was raised to the sublime degree of a Master Mason on June 29th of 2012. About 3 months after that, I went through the York Rite, and about 32 days after that, I went through the Scottish Rite. Became a 32nd degree Mason in 1 day. About 20 years ago, I ran into this book called The Meaning of Masonry. And I had already been studying the Kabbalah and Hermetic philosophy and alchemy for about 12 years, and it fit everything together for me. And I'm going to do a book report on this. I already got them finished for you. But I've basically taken out all the best parts of this book so that you don't have to tread through pages and pages. But yet at the same time, I would highly recommend getting this one. He has a second book called The Masonic Initiation. Definitely tread through The Meaning of Masonry first before this one, but this is outstanding work. Since that time, since the time I found that book, it really set me on fire for Freemasonry. So, as you can see in the front, I've got Morals and Dogma. I've read that probably 6 or 7 times. And I've been through the Encyclopedias of Freemasonry by Mackey. These two books I've seen in every lodge I go to, they are the most esoteric books that I've ever found in Freemasonry, yet I don't meet brothers that read these things, so it just kind of throws me off. I studied Freemasonry a long time before I joined Freemasonry, and even though I'm in the Northern jurisdiction, I still kind of expected it to be what all the authorities or the authors, authorities of Freemasonry, were saying that it was. So 6 years ago when I did get in, it was a bit of a shock, and there was just a lot of difficult emotional things going on there for me, to where I had to stop and back up and see what was going on and try not to get so upset about the whole ordeal. When I studied Freemasonry, I studied it purely from the esoteric aspect. I didn't know there was really another aspect. Everything has an outer or exoteric story. And that's, in essence, what this is. This is monitorial masonry. And that's what Mackey calls this. This is monitorial masonry, or the outer story. But if you take the volume of sacred law along with these encyclopedias and morals and dogma, and basically, with just these three sources, I've created a teaching system for Freemasonry that, as far as I can find so far, doesn't exist. One of the things I really want to cover here is that Freemasonry needs to come back to teaching. We need to start teaching, and we should have been doing it a long time ago. It just hasn't been happening. I'm going to go through a whole lot of stuff by Carl Jung. I'm definitely going to get into the Red Book stuff in the operative videos. You'll figure out what that is in a minute here. But Carl Jung was just an amazing psychologist, father of psychology. Ken Wilber, The Spectrum of Consciousness. I'm going to teach a meditation process that's in this. And it's one of the best. I had meditated for 10 years before and struggled. This made the difference. The first 2/3 of it are all on the mind and how it works and reacts and stuff like that. It's really dry reading. But once you get into the back, it's a jewel. So, anywho, another one that I highly want to recommend is James Price, The Apocalypse Unsealed. Now, this is heavy material here, but at the same time, I found it recommended by Pike in one of his books, by Wilmshurst in one of his books, by Manly P. Hall. All three of these guys are referring to this guy. And this is talking about, basically, it's the Greek interpretation of the Book of Revelation. Outstanding stuff. And it also is associated with St. John the Evangelist. You'll learn more about that later in the video series. As an esoteric Freemason, and I definitely would have to label myself that, I have a deeper obligation, not only to my brethren, but to mankind as a whole. My obligation is in that I have a spiritual responsibility. At least I feel I have a responsibility to nurture and to nurture your spiritual growth and understanding from the esoteric aspect of what we're trying to convey here. So that's the main value of what I'm trying to do, is convey the information in these books without being super complicated. The second thing is basically unveiling the whole ancient mystery school. And that's what all of this really does as a combined effort. The third thing, and to me the most important, and it's the most important thing that I don't see taught, I haven't found it on the internet anywhere, I've looked for it, operative Freemasonry. And I'm not talking about building cathedrals over in France. I'm talking about if you look inside these books, it's talking about, and we've heard these phrases, building a spiritual temple within. That's the operative aspect of Freemasonry. We are to work daily on the building of an inner spiritual temple. It's all through this book work. You'll hear it a bunch of times through all these different videos that I present and get used to the idea. When I took my obligation as a monitorial Freemason, as a Freemason in the state of Michigan, I took an obligation in that I would keep secret all the signs, grips, words, and tokens of Freemasonry. And I was raised in June of 2012, that September, I was at the Scottish Rite, and I got to see a Grand Lodge officer, and I asked him, I says, do I have to ask permission to teach esoteric Freemasonry? He says, well, nobody's going to come. Which, now I've learned that it's just not that popular of a topic. Yet at the same time, to me, it's how you're going to build a spiritual edifice without a spiritual foundation. And that's what these books create. So there will be no, I will be giving no modes of recognition or the grips, signs, words, and tokens of Freemasonry. That's not of any interest to anything I'm doing here. I have to say also that I'm taking full responsibility for every word that I say. And none of this is the opinion of the Grand Lodge of Michigan at all that I know of. And especially, well, I'm just saying, it's not the opinion of the Grand Lodge, anybody else. This is my baby. So if you want to throw rocks, throw them my way. It's not that big a deal. Since I was raised to the degree of Master Mason back in 2012, I started searching online even more so because I really wanted to present more information to my lodge at first. And I found a lot of good stuff, but the majority of everything online is based out of fear and misinformation and superstition rather than actual knowledge and maybe some understanding of what's going on. I wanted to create an education system of proper instruction. I've got all the books, I've got all the authorities of Freemasonry sitting right here in front of me, and it doesn't take that many books to figure out the puzzle. See, all of these books act like pieces of a giant puzzle, and that's the whole thing here, is where we need to be able to search and research and put all those pieces together so that we can see the map. And I got a picture of the map right here. Oddly enough, because this is the map of Freemasonry. I don't know if you can see this right here, but that's the Tree of Life. That's the map I'm talking about, and all these books are talking about that map. Now, I know this sounds a little funny, but in essence, what this is it's a symbol that maps out human consciousness. Not only that, it maps out our psychology, and it also acts as a map on the psychic planes. Now, that may sound a little odd, and I'm sure it does, but at the same time, go through the series and you will totally understand exactly what I'm talking about, and it'll be elementary to you by that time. But I want to create a foundation, and we're in building a spiritual edifice. If we're not creating a spiritual foundation, or if we don't have a solid foundation, our spiritual edifice is just going to fall and crumble. What I intend to do is introduce you to operative Freemasonry. And what I mean by operative Freemasonry are disciplines and practices of an inner nature. Now, a lot of this is psychological stuff. And I would totally encourage anybody to go to therapy and learn some more mental tools. I'm only going to have a handful that I can share with you and just give you some basic ideas of the psychological aspect of what Freemasonry is trying to teach us, smoothing out our rough edges and such. But what I want to get into really more so is the spiritual practices. And the foundation of that is going to be meditation. You learned in the first degree to divest yourself of all the superfluities and vices of life. Well, that's kind of divesting yourself of all that. It's getting quiet, because otherwise you're thinking about it. So in essence, really, that's telling us to learn how to meditate and give God some time back, so to speak. We pray all the time. We pray every day, at least I hope so. But meditation is a form of listening to God. And it's maybe going back to that scripture where it says, be still and know that I am God. And I think that's a good clue. You know, we need to be still and listen once in a while. So these practices of operative masonry are, in effect, the practical aspect. All the philosophy of Freemasonry is basically the philosophy. Then you've got the operative aspect, which is the practice. So you've got a philosophy and practice, so to speak. Here's the thing. With advanced mathematics, they write a paper that's called a proof. Pike is saying the same thing about this system, that it is as exact as an advanced mathematical calculation and as perfect. And those just little lines and jewels like that all through these books that give us clues as to the richness and the treasure that we've actually got right in front of our eyes that we never look at. bottom line on these practices, the whole thing is to help you build that inner temple. And you'll understand more fully throughout some of these other presentations that I'm putting out, that what that's really entailing is a whole lot of inner work with your mind. Learning to control your mind, learning to stabilize it. And then we're going to get into the active imagination of Carl Jung and working with the same process that he did in psychotherapy. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm going to split up the programs into five elements. This is an elemental system. I'm giving you the basics. We're basically an elementary school. So what I'm going to do is have a series of classes in the earth realm, some in the water, air, fire, and spirit. So for the earth element, what we're going to do is do the esoteric interpretation of the first 3 degrees of masonry and the opening and closing of a lodge. That may sound a little odd, but there's a whole lot to it, and it's quite deep, but it's very interesting. So hang on to your hat. It's going to be fun. The water element is the book report series, in which I'll be taking and I'll create book reports out of Mackey's encyclopedias, Morals and Dogma, the book report out of just basically everything you see here. But what I'm trying to do is take the real stake, the real substance out of every book and give you the most meaningful and impactful stuff for the program that's within the system itself. In the air element, we've got a series of presentations. There's Cagliostro's Egyptian Rite. There's The Magic Flute by Mozart, Kabbalah 101, Alchemy 101, Hermetic Philosophy, a little bit of comparative religion, and I'm definitely going to get into astrotheology. Pike gets into astrotheology, and I don't think a whole lot of people are talking about it, and we need to understand this concept in this process. The fire element is of the operative masonry section, where you're basically in the daily labor of building a spiritual temple. Back to that topic. You'll learn a series of disciplines and practices that, in essence, will lead you to the door of the celestial temple. And that may sound like a rich claim, but it's true. So you can, it's like Pike says, you can only prove the system to be true and real. And I've gone through it. And I know a handful of other brothers that have successfully done this too. So trust me, hang on to your hat. It's going to be good. The last series is going to be the spirit of Freemasonry. What that is going to be is basically deeper spiritual instruction from outside resources. One of the ones that I really want to endorse, but yet at the same time I've always not liked the cover, is Modern Magic by Donald Michael Craig. This is a book put out by Llewellyn Publications, and it is an excellent Kabbalah primer, and it's an outstanding research on the mind, the Kabbalah, alchemy, hermeticism, very easy to read, and it fills in a lot of blanks that we're not going to get in different spaces. Some of the other books that I'm going to go through are Barbara Ann Brennan's Hands of Light. And this is in the operative section, because this is a practice, and this is going to be combined with a practice, because I'm going to put a video in on clairvoyance, because if the light of the body is the eye, and if thine eye be single, surely thy whole body shall be full of light. And what that's talking about is this right here. And so one of the videos is seriously on a series of practices to help you open your third eye, or the brow on Mount Moriah. I'm going to cover a whole lot of Rosicrucian stuff. Paul Foster Case's True and Invisible Rosicrucian Order, outstanding work. In one of the first Rosicrucian books, The Alchemical Wedding of Christian Rosencrucz. All you guys that are familiar with the 28th degree, this is basically the essence of the Rosicrucian college in sense. And these not everything's going to happen right overnight. Right now, what I want to focus on is the basic core of Freemason. We're going to get to these edge things in a while. I only have a couple other books here that I actually want to recommend, because I haven't read much in the last 5 to 10 years that I've found outstanding. But check this out. It's outstanding. This guy's great. I've listened to him on YouTube a little bit. Knows what he's talking about. This is good. It's good stuff. And this is new. This is something I found. Lost Art of Resurrection. He's literally taking the writing off the walls of the tomb of Ramses, talking about the living resurrection. And that's what basically all this is about, is the living resurrection. The resurrection of the dead is a central and core event in the initiation process. Plain and simple, without question. You're not truly initiated until you're brought up or raised to the sublime degree of a master mason. This has been practiced for centuries on the living. It was never intended for a dead body to rise out of a grave. Paul says that in Corinthians 15. Over and over and over. He literally calls the guy, the Corinthians, a fool for thinking that the body is going to resurrect. There's a lot of information here. I'm going to try to cut through it slowly, piece by piece. I totally want you to follow along. Pay close attention to everything. Go back. Go over things. And you will quickly see that all this stuff fits together. And you'll see the program fitting together the farther you get into it. Research on your own. Definitely dig. And if, I'm telling you right now, if you're watching this, it can only mean you're ready for the information. So, life of mediocrity can be fun, but I'm telling you, there's more to it. There's something deep in the mysteries of masonry that will give you such a sense of awe that it's unforgettable. And the experience of initiation that it is pointing at is the most incredible experience you'll ever experience, actually. It all depends on your inner desire to know divine truth, because the lost word is divine truth. And if that's the case, the steps are here. If you follow the steps, you can only prove the system to be true. Thank you. Thanks a lot. I really appreciate your time. And again, welcome to Esoteric Freemasonry Unveiled, and I'll see you later.